The year is 1993. It's a year and a half since Wunderkind Steven Soderbergh's sophomore effort, Kafka, landed in theaters with, let's just say audiences greeted it with the sound of one hand clapping. Soderbergh's film about the enigmatic author made producers' money disappear in a way that was more David Copperfield than Franz Kafka. It's safe to say the shine was off the tinsel. Would the 30-year-old director bounce back with his third effort?
Well, it lost less money than Kafka, so a step in the right direction.
I'm calling that a win. Welcome to the Filmographers Podcast, the show where we study a director's entire career, one film at a time. I'm Keir Graff.
And I'm Michael Moreci. We're interested in the big picture. And this season, we're turning the spotlight on Steven Soderbergh, discussing why each of his films succeeded or why they failed, looking at them in the context of the Hollywood landscape at the time it was released. Above all, we want to know how working artists make a life in the arts.
We don't give lengthy plot summaries, and we do share spoilers. We hope you'll subscribe to the pod, watch the films with us, and join us each week as we explore what makes Steven Soderbergh so fascinating, in spite of, or maybe because of, the fact that he's so unpredictable.
For Aaron Kurlander, the Great Depression was a time of great discovery.
What do you think? Looks wonderful.
You want a job?
What do I get?
Why don't you put something on?
Get on my good side.
I have something on.
Got an idea. Might be a little risky. You up for it?
Two partners, us against you. I'll put up five and Bill, you'll put up five against your ten.
When the world turns upside down.
I was just wondering if you'd like to dance.
The trick is coming out on top. King of the Hill.
Before we examine his third feature film, Mike, please describe the plot in one sentence.
All right, I'm going to try to. You've done so well in the first two episodes, so the bar is high. But if I were to say for King of the Hill, a young boy growing up in the Depression is forced into adulthood through the trials and tribulations of raising canaries for cash, eating magazine photos of food, and realizing polite society for all its cruelties.
Well done. Yes, the eating magazine photos of food is one of the most indelible images of the film, of course.
It is.
So, how did we get here? We've talked in the previous pods about the things that Soderbergh was offered post Sex, Lies, and Videotape. This was actually one of the projects that he was thinking about making instead of Kafka. Maybe he should have. I don't know. It's based on a memoir by A. Hotchner, who is an interesting character in his own right. I don't think we'll go into it too much here, but I just want to, you know, if you Google him or you read the New York Times obit, it's worth reading. He's a guy who started out poor, became quite successful in his own right as a writer, and also became a very famous friend of celebrities, including Paul Newman. Became one of Paul Newman's close buds.
Wow.
Yeah. But this book, King of the Hill, was something that he had written and held to be very personal. It was published in the early 1970s, and a number of people had approached him hoping to make it, and he had turned them down because as Soderbergh says so eloquently in his diaries, he didn't want to get sodomized. Well said, Steve. But
this is a good book, the guy lived through the Depression.
So I appreciate that. I feel like we live in an era where everybody's so quick to say, yes, please, sir, turn my, you know, personal memoir into a streaming series or a film or something. Please take it. So here's a guy who actually kind of held on to it. And I guess Redford was instrumental, and Redford, another Paul Newman pal, was instrumental in convincing Hotchner that Soderbergh could be trusted. Soderbergh, typically self-effacing, was sort of saying, you know, wasn't sure himself that he could be trusted with the material. But Redford helped make the connection. Hotchner agreed he was the guy to do it. And Hotchner was very involved in the producing of the film. He was on set. He advised the actors a lot. He talked about what things looked like. He talked about how people would behave. He even... I was going to say famously, I don't think this was a famous thing, but he even coached the young star of the film on how to properly shoot marbles in an authentic way.
Wow. That's cool.
Mike, what did you think of the film?
Well, I'll be candid from the start. this is one of my least favorite Soderbergh movies. You know, we talked in the prior episode, and I'm assuming maybe you listened to it, maybe you didn't, but we talked a little bit about how the core was lacking. You know, Kafka's core, it just didn't have a core that it built around, like a solid, this is what this thing is, and we're building outward from it. You know, there's this sense of like it wasn't, Soderbergh never really found it. And I don't think he found this one either, despite it being based on a book. The difference being that it's far more of a safe movie, and we'll talk about that a lot. But I also think it makes it a little bit boring. It's a little bit of a dull movie. Like, it's on the surface, you have this Depression era, you have a period piece, you have a coming of age tale, and it has in it some of the notes that you'd find, like some adventures, some fun. You know, he learns these things about the world. He has his mentor figure, you know, played wonderfully by a young Adrian Brody, and they get into some, you know, madcap things. And those pieces work, and there's some good pieces in it. But the sum of the parts, if I look back, it just feels like a standing coming of age movie. Didn't really need to be depression besides him getting really hungry, you know, like, and, you know, his brother being sent away is what happened typically during that time, you know, to save money, you shuttle family members mm-hmm. off mm-hmm. to who does have money at that mm-hmm. moment. So there's some details, yes, but I still think, and I think there's really specific reasons to this, as we explore why he made this movie, I still think that it's really lacking a particular, like I said, a particular core that really tapped into Soderbergh's vision. Like I said, and I don't know if, remember if I mentioned this last podcast, I don't think I did. I don't think, and this is going to be weird to say, I don't think Soderbergh has made a Soderbergh movie yet. I don't even think.
Interesting.
That Sex, Lies, and Videotape is a very Soderbergian movie. I like it a lot. I don't think it's a Soderbergh-y movie. Hot take coming in, you know, like, and I think this continue, and I know, and I know, I'm not going to spoil it. I know the movie where Soderbergh becomes Soderbergh, and we'll talk about that soon, but this isn't it. And it's lacking that Soderbergh vision, style, his obsessiveness that come out in other movies, his panache, his flourishes, and King of the Hill just feels, overall flat. Well made, well done. There's some really good craft on hand, the same thing there was at Kafka.
Yep.
But it's just not a movie. It's like a plane that just circled the runway, never really took off and went anywhere.
I agree with you that it was flat. I think that I found it, I guess to me, Soderbergh, I think that the through line is stronger than in Kafka. I think he found this movie more. When I look back and think about how, I think that the kind of epiphany at the end, Jeroen Krabbe, back again. He was also in Kafka in a minor role. Now he plays a larger role. He plays the father of young, Aaron Curlander is the character. Jesse Bradford is the child actor who plays Aaron. So Aaron is the main character in the film. His dad goes away. Like, the process of abandonment in this film is kind of remarkable. Like, this young kid, the height of the Depression, his brother gets shipped off. Then his mom goes into a sanatorium, and then his dad goes off to sell stuff on the road, and this boy ends up alone in a hotel fending for himself. And the abandonment is powerful. And when the dad comes back, and the dad is this kind of like fabulist who's sort of just like, well, everything will be okay when I get that job I've been looking for or whatever. And at the end, when the dad comes back and is oblivious to his son's suffering, and he says, well, we can't sneak our belongings past the hotel management, so just leave it all. I've got this job now. We're going to go into this new furnished apartment. Leave all those things behind. We're fine. I've got a salary now. And his son insists on bringing these things with him because he has fought so hard to keep them in his dad's absence. And the son has gone through this intense transformation. I thought the ending paid off pretty well. However, and so I think Soderbergh knew more what he was doing here. But I agree that the film ultimately doesn't work very well. One of the biggest problems I had with it is that it's too damn pretty.
Yeah.
It just, the cinematography, it's beautiful. It's beautifully lit. It's almost burnished, glowing amber, you know, and it's just the wrong feeling. It feels like this is about extreme poverty and hardship, and it just looks kind of rose-tinted glasses nostalgia or something. And also, Cliff Martinez's soundtrack, I think his soundtracks for the first two films were excellent.
Yeah.
He scored both movies. I think they were really good. I think this one's completely wrong. I mean, there's nothing wrong with it as a composition. It's the wrong thing for the movie. It at times it's almost too cute. It plays off the action on the film almost in a little Disney way.
It's like really whimsy.
Yes.
Yeah. And I think you're right. I mean, that's something that I did appreciate, and maybe I should appreciate it more. But I'm thinking of what you had mentioned before in our discussions about Kafka, where you had that final, well, what should have been the final line from, you know, Obi-Wan McGinnis, or Obi-Wan Guinness, where he says, "Why should today be any different?" And you feel like that's the movie.
Yeah.
That's the thing. And I feel like he is closer. Soderbergh is closer in this one. I like the motif, like you're saying at the end, of lost things. A lot of this movie, and you can also parallel this with Depression, the Depression story, to potentially an immigrant story too. But there is this basement or whatever it is, the storage closet where everyone's possessions end up, and they're just rotting there. Like, these were people's lives, entire lives. That there's a scene earlier where Aaron witnesses somebody getting evicted, and the person's like fighting the bellhop, the bellboy, whatever, to get in his room just so he can get his stuff. And he's not even allowed that. So this is these are people's entire lives. There's paintings down there, really personal stuff, pictures. And there is that cool thread of like things lost and things missing, which happens to Aaron. He just becomes lost and missing. Everybody in his family goes a different direction. He's just kind of left behind, which explains his, you know, emotional connection to his things. You know, he doesn't want them to end up in this storage closet. He doesn't want the bellboy to be in control of that. And I think that's really cool. But I also don't know that that was brought to the fore, like things missing as an overarching universal connectivity. It's just, it's not quite, you know, bringing it all together.
Yeah, that's an excellent point. And Hochner talks about, there's an interview as a DVD extra on the Criterion Edition, which you so kindly lent to me, where Hochner talks about how at that time, people just disappeared from your life because there was so much upheaval. There was no continuity. And neighbors would move and you would never hear from them again.
Yeah.
And I think I agree that could have been a stronger element of the film. The lost items in the storage room is a powerful image that's maybe not used to maximum effect. Another thing that I think does pay off in the ending is there's a, and this is just good cinematic craft. At the beginning, in the very beginning of the film, the scene where Aaron sees this guy locked out of his apartment, and the padlock becomes a really powerful motif in the film because the bellhop is always picking old padlocks out of this box of locks, and one by one, the neighbors are getting locked out of their apartments because they can't pay their rent. And then, in a nice grace note at the end of the film, before leaving the hotel for good, Aaron picks the lock and breaks into the storage room and removes all the keys from the lock. So when the bellhop finally gets his opportunity to lock Aaron's family out of their apartment, the locks are closed and he can't open them because there are no keys. So like, that's almost a Spielbergian touch, I would say. Like, Spielberg is always very big on these objects that pay off later in the film.
Yes.
And so again, that was good, but the film is just too pretty. It's too nice looking. Again, like Sex, Lies, and Videotape, everybody's kind of skin is glowing with this sheen of sweat, which I thought was like kind of appropriate. It's hot St. Louis or something, but it almost echoes the fact that everything else was glowing. In the set constructions, Soderbergh instructed them to like glaze everything and put like layers of varnish on things just to make them glow. And again, wrong choice, I think.
Yeah, there's these curious things going on, which he becomes so masterful later on. Like the way, you know, God, I'm thinking of like Out of Sight, the way how great Florida looks and then how even better Detroit looks. Detroit looks so good at Out of Sight. Like, yeah, it's one of my favorite things in any movie. Yeah. Like, I love it so much. But like, we talked about the curious choice as well in Kafka, the transition from black and white to color and back. Like, I still don't really have my finger on why that decision was really made creatively. I guess we both have some loose ideas, but I really can't discern, like, oh, I get it. You know, like Pleasantville, when Pleasantville becomes color, you're like, oh, because they're the vibrancy. And it's like, which is a little on the nose, but you get it, you know? But I don't really see, I can't discern a reason. And I can't discern, you know, why, like you're saying, a Depression era movie looks so good, you know? Like, and it also kind of undermines the ending because, like, it should be a little bit more powerful, like, that this family made it, because most do not, you know?
Yeah.
Especially, like, in this hotel, we've learned, you know, Adrian Brody's character doesn't make it. The girl, the neighbor that has a crush on Aaron, they eventually move, but I don't think they really want to. And Spalding Gray, terrible things happen to him. Nobody, there's no sense that, like, Aaron is going to make it when they do. But the overall tone, like you said, this upbeatness and the color and all this never really gives you a sense that things are really that low.
Soderbergh said one of the things that attracted him to this film is this kid who, you know, is forced to grow up too soon. He's forced to adopt responsibilities a kid should never have to take on. And that is interesting, but one of the challenges of a story like this, I mean, as you and I know, as writers, as storytellers, your protagonist needs to be active in their own story, and they need to, you know, to some degree, sometimes great, sometimes small, take control of their own story. And this is a story really of kind of survival and resistance. Because he's a powerless kid, there's not much more that he can do than endure his hardships, and his victory is in his endurance. Which is, you know, not without some power, but as you said, the ending feels a little flat because it just kind of, well, his dad comes back and says, oh, I got the job. And I mean, that is something that Aaron has helped bring about. He forwards a key letter from the WPA to his father in the field. Right. So he's helped. But again, it's maybe a flaw inherent in the material. That you can't sculpt it as much as you would if it was not based on biographical material. I think, too, that his, you know, we talk about the unevenness of some of it. Just there's uneven tone throughout in that some of the scenes are really harrowing and serious. I think one of the more powerful sequences in the film is when he's hallucinating from hunger. And Soderbergh actually uses some really interesting visual techniques to kind of show you how he feels. I think that comes off very well because it's much more raw and unvarnished than the rest of the film. But then there are these scenes with this cop who's brutalizing the local kids, where the cop plays it so broadly. It's almost like, I don't know, Roald Dahl by way of Disney, you know, right. and also the bellhop is cartoonishly evil, not a shred of humanity. And this bellhop would not have been, I mean, maybe he's an authority figure, but in real life, he would have been poorly paid and really desperate for the job. And instead, we just see him as a sadist. And so they're both too broad, where some of the other characterizations are a little more nuanced. The sickly girl who lives in the apartment building and who wants to become a friend, or Spalding Gray's character, this kind of like faded aristocrat who's down on his heels and in this same poverty-stricken hotel. Some things are nuanced, and then some things are just overly broad.
Yeah. There's some really, you know, like perfect word, broad strokes happening here. Even Adrian Brody, like, I don't understand his relationship, but the first time I watched, I thought that was like his uncle or something like that. And, you know, he talks about his sick mother, like, to not knock on his door, but then we never know if he actually has a mother. You know, like,
right. There's finally the moment when the door opens and we get to see him, and there's no sign of the mother, but the Adrian Brody character is constantly saying, you know, you can't come in because of my mother. I don't know what that was about.
No, and I don't know really what we learned from, like, what really Aaron learns from him necessarily. He learns how to pick locks, you know. But you're right. I mean, and again, I think this is to your point. There's really nothing I can add, but I also wonder if this has something to do with, like, Soderbergh learning how to use somebody else's material. You know, and like you said, Hotcher's on set. He's there. I mean, like, this could have been just Hotcher being like, this is how I remember it. This is how it was. This is how this cop acted. And maybe he's right. And for real life, especially through, you know, if he was like a child at this time, that's how these things seem. But like, when you're putting it on film and this cop is, you know, basically, you know, just this, like, you know, Keystone cop. I wouldn't say that. He looks like
close,
one, you know, but, you know, like, it just doesn't really work, other than like for him to be, Just too, I don't know, word I'm looking for escapes me, but it's just too broad and just not giving us anything. It's not giving us a dimension to hang on to. But I wonder if, like, Soderbergh is struggling with the idea of how do you take somebody else's thing and how does he make it his thing? Because that's ultimately, I am somebody, and I know there's arguments about this, I'm somebody who does believe in the auteur theory, and I don't believe in a bad way. And it doesn't mean that you can behave badly or to other people. But I do believe in someone who's directed a movie and has worked on film sets, it is ultimately one person making final decisions. Mm-hmm. And that person's the director. The crew is important. The writer is important. The cast is important. These are all vital parts. But one person makes the decision, and that decision is the director.
I think that this clearly shows Soderbergh's learning curve again, because as we said in the last episode, his most successful thing to date has been the thing that originated with himself, and he wrote his own screenplay. And then his next one is somebody else's screenplay, and he stumbles. And then here he's, not only is he adapting somebody else's material, which is a first for him, he's adapting a beloved memoir, you know, that,
yeah,
that
somebody's
very well received, but he has that person on set, which I would love to ask him, Steve, please come on the pod.
Yes.
I would love to ask him about that. And is that a choice he would make today? Would he invite Hotchner to come hang out on the set? I mean, maybe it was great. At the time, he spoke of how helpful Hotchner was. And maybe that's how he felt. And certainly it's great. The marble shooting is more authentic because Hotchner was there. But I can't imagine a worse thing if I were adapting somebody else's material, is to have them hanging around looking over my shoulder. I would like to have access to that person, you know, in the process of, you know, pre-production phase of the film. But I would not want them on set.
No, not at all. Not never. I wouldn't want that at all. Because, you know, there is a vast difference between narrative power and authenticity. And authenticity often gets in the way of, it limits what you can do narratively when you're making something. And you don't need the authenticity as much as you need the power of whatever it is that your film, book, whatever.
Absolutely. Well, before we go to a break, I just want to call out once again that Adrian Brody performance. I think it's a star turn. It's his kind of first significant role, and he just oozes charisma almost so much so that he kind of takes you out of the movie because he's so delightful to watch. You know, Jesse Bradford as the star is fine too. He looks probably too well fed throughout. I want to say I'm not like saying anything about his weight. I'm just saying like he's supposed to be starving to death, and he looks like a very healthy, skin glowing American kid.
Yeah.
Another fun little detail from this is there's a cameo from Lauryn Hill, the musician Lauryn Hill. She plays the elevator operator far before she breaks out. And another little fun musical fact about this that I didn't know until we looked into this. Is the score of the film written by Cliff Martinez. Cliff Martinez was the drummer on the first two Red Hot Chili Peppers albums.
I didn't know that. I can't believe it. You know, I mean, I can because he's so absolutely talented. His scores are great. He's done many, many scores that are terrific.
Yeah.
But he also, was out there with Flea and Anthony Kiedis.
Probably explains why there's an incongruous slap bass at the wrong moment in this film, but I don't know.
Well, at least nobody came out just wearing a sock.
On that note.
But one other thing, by the way, we'll talk about this later, I'm sure, but Spalding Gray, who Steven Soderbergh and Spalding Gray end up forming quite the partnership for years to come.
Absolutely. And it's funny because Spalding Gray, seeing him now takes me out of the movie a little bit because Spalding Gray is Spalding Gray. He became died too soon, but he became such a kind of known figure with such a distinctive style and voice that seeing it now, I'm very conscious that I'm watching Spalding Gray, although I think he did a great job. And when I saw this movie at the time when it came out, I remember being fascinated by that character and that little subplot in that room. I think Spalding Gray and Elizabeth McGovern, who plays a prostitute, is basically sleeping with him for food.
Yeah.
Which is, again, another nice little grace note because there's a moment where Jesse is looking through the transom. And he overhears this prostitute who's going back to the room with Spalding Gray's character, Mr. Mungo. And she's telling him, I don't normally do this. I usually do it for cash up front. And we later understand that she is sleeping with him for food. And then that's brought back in a way where these two adults are talking over the head of our kid protagonist. And Spalding Gray is saying, you should share your food with this kid. And she says, basically, like, well, when he does what I do for it, then he can have some. Well, there's an amazing little callback to that in that the young Aaron actually almost does that. In that this weird girl that lives in his hotel is always saying, come in and hang out with me. He doesn't want to do it. And then she says, would you like a hot dog? And he goes into her room to hang out. So I thought that was like, you know, more of that, please. I mean, that stuff was great and kind of like pulled it together, even though the film tonally wasn't ultimately successful.
Yeah, I didn't pick up on that. That's a great find. Good job.
Thank you very much. We're going to take a short break, but when we come back, we'll be talking about the way Steven Soderbergh's choices cut short what could have been an award-winning, financially successful career still relevant today.
Keir?
I'm sorry. I got lost in an alternate timeline.
Listen to me, Aaron. You're going to be okay. You're a smart boy. You're very smart. I tell you how smart you are. Once when you were less than a year old, your mother was in the sanitarium with consumption, and you would cry every night. So the first few times I picked you up and you stopped crying, so I realized you just wanted attention. So the next time you cried, I got a glass of cold water, and I stood over the crib, and I said, you see this? This is a glass of cold water, so you better stop crying, or you'll be sorry. But you kept crying, so I poured the cold water in your face, and you stopped crying just like that. And from then on, when you cried, all I had to do was to show you the glass of water, and you'd stop crying. Now that's a smart baby for you, eh?
And we're back. So, Sex, Lies, and Videotape was both a critical and financial success. Kafka was not. And King of the Hill, well,
better.
Yeah, it's interesting because Soderbergh now says that when he's recognized, which he claims is not that often, King of the Hill is one of those kind of deep cuts that people say, oh, I just love that movie. That it, people have a personal connection to it.
Interesting.
And the critical response was good at the time. So it was a Palme d'Or nominee at Cannes, but the writing was on the wall when journalists started canceling interviews with him. and then they were all going to talk to Chen Kaig, I don't know how to pronounce that director's name, but who's the director of Farewell My Concubine. And that was the big film that year. And Soderbergh says at the time that he was very philosophical about it. He just said, no, it's this Chen's year. You know, I had my year. And he, I think, intuitively understood, like, I'm not going to be the big deal twice, you know, in several years. So it did not do well in award season. The critics liked it a lot. They were definitely talking about how it was a puzzling choice. Ebert wrote, it's curious that Steven Soderbergh chose this story for his third film since it has no apparent connection with his first two. Sex, Lies, and Videotape, which was a sensational debut, and Kafka, which was a ponderous and an uncompelling follow-up. Now, with the kind of material you'd never dream of associating with him, he has made his best film. So Ebert thought this was better than Sex, Lies. Janet Maslin of the New York Times loved it, wrote it a love letter. Michael Wilmington was an unusual character who used to be the Chicago Tribune film critic. Mm-hmm. For the LA Times, he wrote that King of the Hill is one of the finest American films of the year and one of the few which is really about America. Even today, it's got a 91% on the dreaded tomato meter. I promise not to reference that very often. But so critically, it did well. It was pretty much shut out from the awards. The IMDb page for awards is kind of cringeworthy. It was nominated for Best Picture at the Dallas-Fort Worth Film Critics Association Awards. So it was shut out from awards. And the box office, well, it cost $8 million to make and earned $1.2 million back. So I did a little quick analysis. Kafka cost $11 million and earned $1.1 million, so it earned back 10% of what it cost. King of the Hill cost $8 million and earned back $1.2 million, so it earned back 15% of what it cost. So,
well, that's just, you know, like we said, a step in the right direction.
Yeah. You can only go up from there.
Yeah, I mean, it's... You know, it's interesting. It's interesting the time that this was released in 1993, because what I wanted to look at here is that, like, I feel like there's some whiplash going on. Is that you go from, after Sex, Lies, and I mentioned this in the past show, he made Kafka, which is like this really, really arty movie. You know, this black and white, this German expressionistic thing, and it does very, very poorly. And then, like, the pendulum swings so hard, and he makes this really, really studio, and I'm gonna put quotes on this, prestige. And I say prestige because we're still in a time. So 1993, like we said before in the Sex, Lies episode, the indie scene is, like, really gearing up. It's really becoming something. It's getting bigger and bigger and bigger. But there is still these vestiges of the 80s of, like, the really safe, glossy, which might explain the look of King of the Hill, comforting studio prestige movies. You know, you look at the 1993 Best Picture nominees, two of which were, for God's sakes, Howard's End and Scent of a Woman, which laughed at both of those, which I should be more articulate, but that's all I could kind of, you know, hairball I can only cough out for those films. But, like, you see Soderbergh, part of this might be, like, the knee jerk of him being like, hey, I can make a studio movie. You know, like, yeah. And he sure did, you know, and I think that's where part of the critics' praise comes from, is that, like, it looks great. It's made great. It's certainly not challenging. It's not like Kafka where you walk away and you're like, what the hell was this? You know, it's a very digestible, prestige, studio, glossy movie, which it was still in vogue in 1993. So I get, you know, the reason for him making it. I don't know, and probably talk about this more, probably not the right reason for making it for his career and for the artist that he ultimately becomes. But I also understand the praise, understand why he makes it. But it's just so interesting, you know, that whiplash between these movies is wild.
It is wild. And he definitely talked a lot about kind of putting that studio gloss on it. You know, he kind of wanted to deliver the value for money or something like that. It's interesting because Miramax is big films. I mean, of course, Miramax is the distributor of Sex, Lies, and Videotape and helped him get his big start. I mean, and he helped Miramax break through, too. I mean, that's really important connection there. And their big films in 1993 were The Crying Game, Like Water for Chocolate, and The Piano. They also did Farewell, My Concubine, the Palme d'Or winner, but that only grossed about $5 million. Right. So that actually arguably was a bigger failure. But the box office top movies in 1993, we got Jurassic Park, The Fugitive, The Firm, Sleepless in Seattle, Mrs. Doubtfire. And yeah, you could kind of see how this fits in almost a little more with those kinds of movies, maybe at least just in vibe, if nothing else. But meanwhile, the independent stuff that he had kind of, he helped kick off the indie era. And so bubbling under, like, films that didn't make a lot of money, but the films that got made in 1993, indie films, were like Bodies, Rest, and Motion, Jennifer Lynch's Boxing Helena, Richard Linklater's Dazed and Confused, Dominic Sena's debut, California, Allison Anders with Mi Vida Loca, John Dahl's Red Rock West, a personal favorite of both of ours, and even Kenneth Branagh's Much Ado About Nothing, although it doesn't feel like that. That was an independent film and one of the bigger independent films of the year. But it feels like those people were still working in the way Soderbergh was working with his first film. And he's already kind of, you know, I guess he's already telling us maybe, like, I'm not ultimately an independent filmmaker.
No. And I think, you know, well, two things. One that I would say is that I don't know, I don't want to be unfair to critics because I don't think that critics understand him yet, you know, mm-hmm. because he hasn't, you know, reached his final form. but I think, like, he's treated as an art house guy because of Sex, Lies. And now he's treated as a studio guy. And he's really not either. He's both and he's neither. And that's what makes him so fascinating. But also, as much as the indie scene is coming along and gaining momentum, the really big change occurs, at least for me, what I consider is 1995, is when Pulp Fiction gets nominated for Best Picture. You know, it's funny, I just read Mark Harris's book, Pictures at a Revolution, and he talks about the 1968 Academy Awards nominees, the five pictures, and how divisive they were in the sense that, like, there was just this wrestling between the old Hollywood and the new. You know, you have this, like, just a wedge between the movies. On one hand, you got Dr. Doolittle, which everybody then and everybody now agrees is utter garbage. but it was the Roadshow musical. And Roadshow musicals got nominated for Best Picture. That's just kind of what happened. You had Guess Who's Coming to Dinner, which was like 10 years behind the race conversations. But it had Spencer Tracy in his last role. And it had Katharine Hepburn. So you had like the nostalgia factor.
Yes.
You had In the Heat of the Night, which was, I think, is a great film. But it was like not quite the progressive movie of the time, but close enough and really well made. You know,
sure,
I think it's Norman Jewison shot the hell out of it. And then you have the new kids. You got you have Bonnie and Clyde.
Yeah.
And you have The Graduate. So you have like this, the weirdest blend. And that same thing happens in 1995. You know, Pulp Fiction is like basically like your Bonnie and Clyde. And that's when the change happens again, where there's this rift between the old and the new, between your Scent of a Woman, which kind of go away at this point.
Yeah.
And then your Pulp Fictions, which is like rule 90, you know, Miramax and that type of movie rule between 95 to early aughts. So you have this fascinating moment where, like, Soderbergh, I don't know that he would make another Sex, Lies, and he kind of has, but like, he's also, it's not the 90s that we think of the 90s, where it's like, oh, indie movies have taken over. They haven't quite yet. They're being made. They're not all, as you point out, financially successful. They're not getting really rewards. I mean, Piano won Best Supporting Actress for Anna Paquin, I believe, right?
Yeah. Yep.
Okay. So there's some stuff, but even Piano's kind of prestige-y, you know?
Yeah.
And a wonderful movie, don't get me wrong. But like, it's not the world that we think it is. So Soderbergh's still navigating his way, because while he did contribute to the beginning of the indie boom, the indie hasn't like boomed in the way you think that it just overnight, you know, these are all the movies that are being made. Like, no. Like, there's still Scent of a Woman still being nominated for Best Picture.
And he met, when he went to Cannes for Sex, Lies, and Videotape, he met Jim Jarmusch. And talk about the quintessential independent filmmaker, right? Like, Jarmusch owns his films. He owns them. Nobody could take them away from him. And Soderbergh kind of marvels at that when he meets Jarmusch. But that's not the route he's meant to travel. You know, he's a guy, and this is one of the reasons why I think we are so excited about, you know, this season and following Soderbergh's career, is that he's a guy who will make an independent film when it suits his purposes, when he becomes interested in it. But he seems eminently comfortable working the studio system once he finds his feet. He hasn't found his feet yet, but he seems like he's gravitating more towards that at this point, because he's not being the, you know, enfant terrible, you know, he's not trying to like, you know, he's not fighting with the financial backers and saying, no, I got to make this with my vision. He's eagerly pursuing collaborations with people. He's looking for material, and he wants to get into the world of Hollywood and play, basically. And he's not like the punk rock kid who's, you know, keeping it all at arm's length.
No. I mean, exactly. I mean, that's the thing that we talked about before. Like, he's still that guy. He's still that on time and on budget guy, you know? And I think, you know, despite the failures that he has had, and there's still a few more to come. Like, he still gets to come and play because he failed relatively small, and because he's still doing the job the right way, and he's very competent at the job. So, I mean, he's not that guy. He's going to make studio films. Like, he's not the punk rock DIY, do it yourself. Yeah. There you go. he's not that guy, you know, but it's just, I think he's just looking for the content to fit those impulses, because the impulses are there, like the indie weird experiment that is Kafka, and then the glossy studio picture that is King of the Hill. So like, those impulses of like navigating many worlds all exist. It's just he's not finding the right projects that are suiting what he can do.
I think let's take a short break here, and when we come back, we're going to talk more about what makes Steve run, or as I put it in the show notes, why, Steve, why?
What I like in films about children is the conflicts feel bigger, especially when you confront a child with something that would probably either completely derail or destroy an adult. And I think that's what makes them, when they work, so intense, as you're conscious as a viewer, that it's kind of, I don't know if unfair is the right word, but certainly more intense to see a child going through something that they're probably not equipped to handle yet. Especially when they're given responsibilities that are really responsibilities that should belong to an adult. The book seemed to be full of incident, even though it was a memoir. The construction of it was kind of great, you know? Like, it seemed very clear to me how this could work, because it did have a nice landing. This kid gets sort of caught up in a tree and people throw rocks at him for three acts, and then you get him down at the end. And I felt like that could be a really compelling story to tell. It seemed very visual to me. The movie's about, in essence, him shifting from being a child to being an adult in a very short window of time.
So at this point in his career, Steven Soderbergh has already had real highs and lows. Obviously, Sex, Lies, and Videotape was a breakout indie hit, offering him the rare opportunity to choose his projects. But after two commercial flops, one has to wonder how much longer this could last. Now, I want to talk about his choices, but before we speculate on what makes Steven Soderbergh run, Mike, I want to ask you for your bank account and PIN number. I want to ask you why you choose the projects you do and how you weigh art against commerce. I mean, you're an artist, you're a craftsman, and you're a husband and father with two kids, a house and a car, or maybe two cars for all I know.
Just the one. Yeah. So it gives me total freedom. It's the second car, Keir.
Second car is where they get you.
That's the secret that they don't tell you. No, I mean, look, we both know, and I think it's important to explain, you know, like when you're a freelancer, and this is now a freelance writer and doing whatever it is, like we've talked about before, we are both jack of all trades. You know, you do your ghostwriting and you do your middle grade books and you do your collaborations for adult books. You do a lot. You wear a lot of different hats. I do directing. I do screenwriting. I do my comics. Like that is the way it goes. You know, I've been doing this now for like, I believe it's going on 8 years, you know, not working a day job. And there are obviously, there is a balance that has to happen. And there are a few writers I know that don't. You know, I'm often surprised when I hear, like, you know, somebody who I think, even from my perspective, like, oh, they've got it made. And they're like, I don't know what's happening. You know, like, I don't know what's happening from one project to the next. There's the 1%, the rare air that is able to pick their own project, work at their own pace, you know, do things as they wish, you know, and still have two cars, you know. But like, for the rest of us, it's a balance. There are projects that I love and I carve out time for. You know, for people who don't know, spec work. You're writing it speculatively because you don't know if it's going to be published, produced, drawn, whatever the case may be, whatever the medium you're navigating. And those are the projects that I want to do. And I know sometimes with great confidence that I can get them sold or I can get them somewhere or I can at least get someone interested beforehand. And then there's the ones that are really the lottery tickets, you know? But balancing that out, I have to take what's called work for hire, you know, where it's just like, I'm going out, either people are coming to me or I'm coming to them, and I'm finding work basically that'll pay, you know, like there's no spec involved. Like here's the page rate, you know, Stranger Things is one of those gigs. And I love writing Stranger Things, but that's a work for hire. That's a gig where I'm writing somebody else's thing.
Yeah.
And the trade-off though is the artistic trade-off, the creative trade-off, you know, even though I'm proud of that stuff. And it, as a matter of fact, the Stranger Things series I'm doing now, I'm just going to plug it. The Voyage is one of the best things I've ever done. And I love it. But more times than not, the trade-off is that you have less artistic and creative freedom. You know, when somebody else is, you know, writing the checks and it's somebody else's, you're playing in somebody else's sandbox, you know, the kind of the rule creatively is you take the toys off the shelf and you play with them for a little while and then you put them back exactly how you found them, you know? And you don't get to change. If you're writing a Star Wars thing, you don't get to change the timeline, the continuity.
You haven't created any new characters that are now part of the canon?
No, and if I did, God forbid, I wouldn't get paid.
Right, yeah, because it's other people's intellectual property.
Precisely. So there is a trade-off. There is, like, you know, I get paid and I get the security and I get the comfort and I need that and that's great. But I also get a little less creativity, but I balance it out by finding time to do those things that are mine. It's just a little bit more risk, you know, and that's the gig for 95% of us working writers, directors, whatever.
Yeah, I know a fair number of working writers and none of them do it exactly the same. I mean, a fair amount of people teach, even some very successful, you know, more whatever, literary novelists teach for additional money or do editorial work. Some of them are working with other people's IP. Some people are writing a series that maybe they originated, but in some way you could kind of almost argue they're now working for the series because, you know, they've got to keep cranking out a book a year in that popular series and pleasing their readers, which maybe is the greatest thrill in the world for them, or maybe they kind of feel a little stuck in that. I mean, it can go different ways, but there aren't too many novelists, you know, and I'm thinking like your Stephen Kings or your Dennis Lehanes or something who get to just sit down, dream up whatever the hell they want to do and go out and sell it. I mean, that's not the case for most of us. And I think while you were talking, something that occurred to me is that when I was starting out and I had no expectation of really making money, I had the hope, but not the expectation of making money from my work, I was really just coming up with ideas that I thought were interesting. Maybe I thought I was thinking about them in terms of how they would be received, but I didn't have a commercial expectation for them necessarily. Now that I've been doing this for a while, 13th book is coming out next year, I find that I cannot think of a project without thinking about the financial ramifications of that and its saleability. And in fact, it's almost like, I find myself like anything I create, I'm always kind of thinking like, is there a way to sell this, market it, you know, upsell it, make a little more on it or whatever, which is, you know, maybe a little unfortunate. It's not the end of the world. It's a real privilege to be a full-time writer, making a living from my wits, as it were. But to do that, I now have to internalize all the financial decision alongside the creative decision.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and I think that part of this that you can really point to, going back to Steven Soderbergh in a moment, is that one of the best things I think for you, and I think we would both share this, is that we know how to behave. You know, there's a lot of writers and directors and actors, everybody, creative, artistic people. I'm gonna shock some people. We're pretty, art folk don't always behave well.
And some of them are dicks.
Some of them may be temperamental, you know, who knows? But we know how to behave, you know? I think that's when, I remember talking to a writer friend who will mention this off the show, who's written many books. And from my perspective, and we both know this friend, I'm like, well, his books do great. And he one day he's like, hardly any of my books make money. At least that's what the publisher says. But he still gets to do it because he knows how to do the job.
Yeah.
He does it. He does it well. He's never, you know, rocking the boat with his editors or a publisher.
Yeah.
He's never publicly making bad statements, you know, anything like that. And he wouldn't, because he's a good person, which helps. But I think that's part of Soderbergh's thing too. Like, he is a guy who knows how to do the job, not only artistically competent, can get the job done, can do it without blowing up a budget and being a pain in the ass. He's also just a seemingly a good person on set and runs a good set and everyone's happy and he's efficient. Part of this life in the arts is also just knowing how to behave.
Well said. Well said. And I certainly attribute a large part of, you know, I mean, my talent may be arguable, but my work ethic, I think, is, I can say, is indisputable. And certainly one of the things that I've learned in just over doing this many projects is that, you know, there's always somebody else with a better book. There's always somebody who can do what we do better than us. And there's, so one of the reasons that you will be chosen to do a project is because you are pleasant to work with and you come in on time and you're just a pro. And so I certainly have always tried to be a pro. And I also just try to be very respectful to other people in the community. You know, there's a famous Montana writer and teacher, William Kittredge, who would tell his writing students at the University of Montana that the world of publishing is a town the size of Miles City, Montana. You don't have to be from Montana as I am to intuit that Miles City, Montana is not a large place. And basically what he was trying to teach them as he was sending them off in the world to be writers was, what you say, and you may think you're saying it in confidence to somebody, is going to get around town pretty fast. And also, if you alienate one of those people in that small community, you never know how that's going to boomerang back on you. And you also may just be cutting yourself off from future, you know, collaborators. And that's not to say like, oh, be a people pleaser and be agreeable with everybody if they're trying to screw you. But it is just, if you want to work for a lifetime in the arts, you've got to get over yourself and get along with people.
Yeah. Yeah. Don't be a maniac, which is seemingly a pretty low bar. Not everyone can, you know, but it's like I tell my kids though, and you know, I think this is a testament to Soderbergh. a life in the arts is often just an endurance race. That's all it is. It's just sticking around and sticking it out. And what's, I don't think we've talked about this, what's also fascinating and really cool about Soderbergh is that, like, he never stopped, you know, like, not like he had Kafka did poorly, all these movies that did poorly, like, they're still within like a year or two with each other. He picked himself up off the mat and he got back to work.
Yeah.
Like Kafka, he could have went into like, okay, I'm going to rethink things and I'm going to, I'm going to go away for a while. Same thing with King of the Hill. But he didn't, he just kept going. He just kept working and just doing the job and proving that he can do the job.
Yeah, absolutely. And so let's get back to him. I love sharing kind of a little bit about ourselves and what brings us to Soderbergh and like how we relate to him. And hopefully that'll give listeners a little bit more of a handle on kind of who we are. But let's get back to talking about him. And I want to talk a little bit more about his choices. We've talked a lot about how disparate these choices are, right? So far, he's made a small, richly imagined character drama, a mannered black and white mystery biopic of one of the 20th century's most inscrutable authors, and a warm, sepia-toned coming-of-age story set in Depression-era St. Louis, which begs the question, why? Why these in this order? Is there anything that connects them other than that they were films he could make and get financing for?
Yeah, I mean, that's a great question. Because I'll being totally frank, I look at Kafka. I almost said Kafka. It's like the Costco Kafka. Like there's a story there. But anyway, I look at Kafka and I'm like, why the hell did you make this movie? This $10 million black and white. I can't for the life of me understand, you know, but like, I'm glad he did, you know, it takes courage. And he surely had his reasons, but like, I don't know. I mean, yeah, part of it could just be, it's the thing that I know firsthand from working in film is this, like, whatever gets the money is what you're doing. You know, that's the hardest thing. It comes as no surprise, is getting the money. The money is your biggest object. Money cures all, but money kills all at the same time. And like, maybe these are just the movies that, you know, somebody had $10 million for this and $8 million for King of the Hill. Mm-hmm. But it is, if you remove that, it's still a really interesting thing, because he's a guy who's been defined now we have the privilege of time he knows how to pick projects and knows better. He knows how to manage projects.
Like, yes,
I'm going to take this risk on the girlfriend experience. I'm going to shoot it on digital. We're going to do it quick. We're going to do it like this down and dirty $1 million thing, you know, but he didn't know how to creatively, I don't think, pick projects. You see the seeds, you see them being mm-hmm, planted, mm-hmm. but like, you don't really see him taking total shape until much later.
Yes. Well, let's let him weigh in here a little bit. I wish I had the audio for this, but I have an interview or a quote from an interview with him that sheds a little light on what he was thinking anyway, even if we're not seeing it.
Right.
So he says, I think if there is a connection between the three films, he's referring to his first three films, it is a protagonist who feels at odds with everyone around him. And again, is very interior. Always nice to put interior things on screen. That's me sidebarring there. I guess that's my feeling in general. And I go toward that kind of material. It's been interesting to see the reaction, because there is sort of a parlor game that goes on amongst critics, journalists, people in the film business about, you know, is he an auteur? To me, it's more amusing than anything else. The career I would like is John Huston's or Howard Hawks's, you know, very varied, many different subjects. When you talk about Hawks or Huston or Wyler, they were never fashionable or hip or trendy or prone to fads. That's the career I would like. I'm not a visionary. I'm not Fellini. I'm not Kubrick. I'm not Fritz Lang. Sometimes I wish I were, but I know that I'm not, and I'm not trying to be. Those people changed the language. Altman, too. Their films are not like anybody else's. They were different, and they pushed the language of cinema into a new era. I'm more somebody who responds to a piece of material and works to find a style that I feel is appropriate. I'm not interested in imposing a style on a piece of material. That's a pretty long quote, but what I think he's saying is that he wants to be the third Coen brother.
Well, we already know the Barton Fink connection.
Yes, right? Yes, so. Absolutely. So, Mike, are we already three films in seeing a developing theme of Steven Soderbergh, the artist, balancing commercial concerns? He mentions in an interview that he tried to keep his first few films to 100 minutes because he had heard it made it easier for the theater owners to turn the house around.
Yeah, I mean, that's fascinating that he made that decision. But, you know, I mean, look, first of all, I don't think he gives himself enough credit. He's not Kubrick or Hitchcock or whoever. I agree with that. These are directors who have an indelible and unmistakable voice, or who, as he said, changed the language. And that's a perfect way of putting it.
Yeah.
But Soderbergh's powers lie in him being a chameleon. Like, that's what's so great about him. It's something that many directors can't do. They can't keep their ego out of the movie, out of the creative process. You know, like, I mean, yeah, you hear these stories about like Kubrick and the lengths and the obsessiveness. And don't get me wrong, and we'll talk about this soon, Soderbergh certainly has his own obsessions. But like, he's able to keep that in check really, really well. Like, even Spielberg, you know, for all his commercial glory, has, you know, Spielbergian flourishes that are all his own. Now, that doesn't mean that Soderbergh is without a voice, because he does have a voice. He very much has a voice. But that adaptability, ability to keep his ego in check, where like the people he mentioned, you know, don't, for better or for worse, it's like a new kind of auteur, you know, the one that can bring this, you know, dignity and style and artistry to every single project he touches, and allows him to touch a lot more projects too. You know, right now though, while we're not seeing his instincts pick the right project, those aren't fully formed, you know, we're still seeing his commitment to make successful projects. Like, he knows the path to making your next movie is through the success of your current one. And that success, it's not only measured, like we were talking about, by numbers, but also by reputation. You know, Soderbergh is a director who failed many times after one monumental success, mm-hmm. you know, something that was, those failures, and I'm sure we'll get to, were important. They're part of his artistic path. But part of the reason he was given more opportunities, because, you know, A, you know, he still had Sex Lies videotape sure. in his pocket, and people were eager to see that success be duplicated. But B, like we just said, he knew how to do the job, and he did it well enough to know that the bottom line, on time and on budget, was really important to people, especially the ones who signed the checks.
Yeah, absolutely. And it feels to me almost like, you know, he is using making those films as his real film school. And because, as you say, because he's doing it on time and on budget, people trust him. And that's a huge thing. I mean, how many filmmakers have blown up their career on their second or even their first movie by going overtime and feuding with the studio, all that stuff? You quickly get the reputation, they're difficult to work with. His first film made exponentially, you know, so it made so much more than its budget that he literally had something in the bank, you know, like he had a reputation in the bank, he had goodwill in the bank. People felt that he had another hit in him and that he could earn it back. And they weren't worried that he was going to, you know, go 10 times over budget on his next film. So that's absolutely huge. And because he's so, you know, one of the things we've talked about is how almost any criticism we level at these early films, he levels at them too. I mean, I can't think of how many times you and I have said something about them, or I've thought something about, or I've made a note about one of his films that's negative. And then I find an interview or a commentary track or something where he's saying the same thing. He is really hard on his own stuff. And that's why he learns so much, is he has that ability to be hard on his own material. And as I said earlier, he talks about how fortunate he was to have these opportunities to try and try again. I actually had the quote. He says, "Filmmakers now don't get to make the mistakes I made. They really don't. And I needed those mistakes. And I feel bad. Everybody's expected now to emerge just full blown right out of the gate. And I needed those early movies to figure out what I was up to."
Yeah, I mean, that's huge. I mean, that's such a huge thing. I mean, I think he mentioned before, to add on to that, like, everybody forgets that Woody Allen made Interiors between Annie Hall and Manhattan, you know, like, and he needed to make that movie he needed to, for whatever reason, mm-hmm. whatever came out of that, he needed to make that film. And for better or worse, however we feel about them, and like you said, Soderbergh seems to feel the same, he needed to make these movies.
Absolutely. So any final thoughts on King of the Hill before we wrap?
You know, I wish it were, you know,
more depressing of a depression movie.
But no, I mean, we're being a little unkind to it. But, you know, and I should qualify what I said, because as I said, it's not my favorite Soderbergh. It's one of my least favorite Soderberghs. But that's not just it's not a knock on the movie. It's a testament to how much I love what's to come.
Yeah. Well, I think this seems like a good note to end on, especially as we move toward yet another worthy failure. Still more worthy failures to come. And we'll be back right after a short break. So now that we're three films into our Steven Soderbergh film project here on The Filmographers, how are you feeling about it, Mike? Are you seeing the seeds of the career that will take shape? Or are you seeing a guy that's just flailing and jumping from one project to another?
Well, you know, like we said before, we have the privilege of time. You know, we're looking back through a history seeing these movies. But if I'm being honest, at the time, you know, yeah, I would see a guy who's flailing around. You know, like, while he did kickstart this indie movement in 1989, now it's 1993 going on 1994. So you're getting 4 to 5 years of separation from that. And you're getting all these other movies that you mentioned coming out from that scene, that indie scene. And he's starting to get passed up a little bit. You know, time is not on his side. The growth that's happening around him is making him look, you know, separate him even more from Sex, Lies, and Videotape. So, you know, now we know now that he figures it out. And we know now that these were, like we said, the failures, the missteps were all part of the process and were necessary, as painful as they may have been for him and maybe for the people watching them too. But like, they were necessary. We know now. But at that time, if you're somebody who's looking at Steven Soderbergh, you're starting to get a little worried, I would say.
Yeah. And we know that Hollywood is very much about the now, about the moment. They're not about the, oh, this guy will mature in 5 to 10 years. So at the time, yeah, I think probably not just us, but the executives are probably saying, well, how much more capital can we give this guy? So what's the next logical choice for our man, Steve? Well, you guessed it, from a Depression era coming of age, we're headed for a neo-noir set in Austin, Texas, and starring some of the greatest eyebrows in modern film. Those belong, of course, to Peter Gallagher, last seen in Sex, Lies, and Videotape.
Yeah, he's back. and we'll be back too. But for now, if you've enjoyed this episode, please subscribe and take a moment to give us a good rating or review on your platform of choice. Even better, tell a film-loving friend to join us on our journey to watch all the films of Steven Soderbergh. You can also follow us on Instagram at The Filmographers or on X at FilmographerPod. And we are also on Letterboxd.
Special thanks to Kevin Lau, our producer, logo designer Cosmo Graff, and Gomson for our theme music.
And if you have any feedback, any suggestions, want to share a fun Soderbergh fact, if we got something wrong, we'd love to hear it. Email us at filmographerspodcast@gmail.com.
Well, we may grudgingly accept it rather than love it to hear. Join us next week on the Filmographers Podcast, where we discuss Soderbergh's fourth film, The Underneath.
Here, if someone's coming to Chicago, what's one place they should visit?
Well, I would say Calumet Fisheries, but that burned down. You can still see the famous bridge where the Blues Brothers jumped over the Calumet River, though. Maybe the Rat Hole in Roscoe Village, where you can see the outline of a rat that died in the wet cement when they were pouring a sidewalk.
Okay, well, I take it you're not a fan of the usual tourist stuff. No Navy Pier, Sky Deck Bean, Pizzeria Uno, nothing?
Well, everybody knows about those. Actually, there is one Chicago landmark no visitor should miss.
Which is?
Exile in Bookville, Chicago's most Instagrammable bookstore. The name is a tribute to the classic Liz Phair album, Exile in Guyville. I can't wait until someone names a bookstore after us.
You're right, Keir. Exile is the best. Wall to wall, floor to ceiling books, all lovingly curated by owners Javier Ramirez and Kristen Enola Gilbert. Even if you don't know what you're looking for, I guarantee you'll find something to read. Their recommendations are always on point.
Their strong suit may be general and literary fiction, but I particularly love The Middle Room. That's where you find books about art and music, graphic novels, cooking and cocktails, and the filmographer's personal favorite, film books.
Like the store itself, it's small but lovingly curated. Javier and Kristen were kind enough to let us recommend our favorite film books, so stop by and see.
I wrote a shelf talker for one of my all-time favorites, Kyle Buchanan's Blood, Sweat, and Chrome, the wild and true story of Mad Max Fury Road. Everyone who worked on that movie is a legitimate hero.
They also stocked one of my favorites, Sam Watson's The Big Goodbye, Chinatown and the Last Years of Hollywood. Exile also has the best small press selection I've ever seen. Weird books, but good books. Oh, and the best in modern horror.
Don't forget the pens and stationery.
Oh, I won't. I actually just got a Miyazaki-themed journal for my kids.
They also have some of the most interesting author events around. From their horror book club and their film club to big-name visiting authors, there's always something cool going on there.
You said it, Keir. Listeners, if you're coming to Chicago, don't leave without visiting Exile in Bookville on the second floor of the beautiful historic fine arts building at 410 South Michigan Avenue. That's exileinbookville.com and at Exile in Bookville on Instagram.
Because there's more to life than movies. There are books, too.
About movies.